Hello, Julie Thomas.
Yes, hi.
Hello there, my name's Dr. Beddy. Mm. I'm one of the new GPs in the practice.
Right.
And I'm seeing you today instead of Dr. Jones, who's your usual GP.
Yes, he is, yeah.
First of all, what would you like me to call you?
Oh, Julie's fine.
Okay, yeah. Okay. Right, Julie, so what is it that's brought you to see me today?
Well, it's the same thing that I see Dr. Jones about, it's my heart.
Yeah, I understand that you've been in to see him a few times over the last few months. Mm. Would you mind if I ask you to go over again what the problem is, perhaps in your own words, so that I get an understanding of it?
No, not at all. It's just I keep getting these situations where my heart starts to really, really race, like boom, 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 boom.
Right.
I get chest pains. Uh-huh. I can't catch my breath, and it's making me feel funny talking to you about it.
Right.
And so my heart starts to race. I can't get my breath, and then I get chest pains, and I get very afraid that I'm going to have a heart attack.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah. And you're feeling a little bit anxious just here with me?
I am, yeah, just talking about it. Okay. I can feel it starting to come up.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, take your time.
Okay,
your time.
Thank you.
So your heart starts to race, it really beats really fast, and you feel like you can't catch your breath, is that right?
That's exactly it, yes,
How long's all this been going on for, Julie?
I think it's probably about 6 months, basically,
And can you remember what happened to start it all off?
I think we have had some problems at work.
Right.
I've felt more stressed about work than I normally do. Mm-hmm. And basically, I was just trying to get into town one day on a day off, and it was very hot, one of those funny hot days. And it just happened. My heart just started to race and race and race, and I couldn't get my breath. I was just like gasping for breath. Mm-hmm. Then I started to get chest pains, and it was just awful. And I managed to sit down and call my husband, and he came out. He actually left work to come and get me.
Right. So that sounds like quite an unpleasant experience.
It was awful.
For you,
it was really, really frightening. Yeah.
And when that was happening to you, Julie, when you were in the middle of town, what was it that you thought was going on?
I thought I was having a heart attack.
You thought you were having a heart
attack? I really did, yeah. And each time it happens, I'm so afraid that that's what's happening.
Right, okay.
So, you know, I've started to try to avoid situations where I might get like that, basically.
Right, so what kind of things are you finding yourself avoiding?
I can't get into town now without my husband taking me. So my husband has to take me to and from work.
Right.
And then I also thought I shouldn't do anything to put any strain on my heart at all. So I just don't do much exercise or anything at the moment.
Right.
And other things as well.
And other things. What sort of other things are you not doing?
Just personal things. Really.
Personal things. Yeah. Okay. I guess I'm wondering if you're talking about your sex life there.
Yeah.
Right.
I just feel, you know, that I shouldn't do anything like that because it just might put too much strain on me.
Right. So you're avoiding sex in case that puts your heart rate up.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. Okay. Mm. How's that affecting things between you and your husband?
My husband's getting really fed up with it, to be honest, Doctor. He's been really, really kind and really supportive, but I think it's starting to affect his life quite a lot now.
Right.
I mean, he wanted me to go to the pub last week, and I absolutely promised that I would, because I've begun to stop wanting to go out because I'm so afraid it's going to happen. And I promised and promised him I'd go to the pub, and then when it came to it, I just couldn't. I just sat on the sofa and it started to happen again.
Right.
And then I was worried that if I went to the pub, I'd actually like get ill in the pub, and then it would be really embarrassing for everybody. So I just said I couldn't go. And I think he's getting a bit to the end of his tether now, because it just seems to have come out of the blue, and I've never suffered from anything like this before.
So it sounds like he's getting to the end of his tether, but it also sounds like you're pretty fed up with the whole thing as well, Julie.
Yeah,
is that right?
Actually, yeah.
Okay. So just so that I've got the story straight, this all began about 6 months ago. Before that, had you had anything like this?
No, not at all. I mean, I think that we had a new manager at work. I work in a bank, actually, and then we had a new computer system put in. And so it became very much more stressful for all the staff, not just me.
Right.
And that's, I can sort of see that I was under a lot more pressure, and that could be affecting me.
So to make sure I've got the right way around, it began 6 months ago. Pressure at work, you went to town, you had the first of these attacks, and then since then you've had some more of them, and now it's kind of got to the point that you don't want to go out,
you don't
go to town by yourself.
No, I don't want to risk it, to be honest.
You're not going to the pub, you're not socialising like you used to, and you're avoiding things like exercise and things like sex, and that's having a bit of a, taking its toll on
it
your relationship.
Yeah.
Okay. And looking at your I know you've had an ECG that Dr. Jones organised for you a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
What have you been told about the results of that?
Well, Dr. Jones said that it was okay and there were no problems. And, you know, I did feel relief, you know, because obviously there's been heart attacks in my family. My dad died of one, you know, at 72. Okay. So I'm thinking it must be my heart. There must be something wrong with it.
Right.
And I did feel pleased when Dr. Jones said that. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, nothing's changed, you know. I'm still getting exactly the same problems.
Okay.
Nothing... You know, I'm not getting any help with it.
Right.
I just feel a bit like, well, so I haven't got a bad heart, according to the experts, but I'm still getting all the same symptoms, you know, worse and worse.
So even though the GP's told you there's nothing to worry about with your heart, do you still worry that there might be something wrong
with
your heart?
I do. I can't understand it.
Right.
Well, what do you think it is, Doctor?
Well, Julie, I think I'd agree with Dr. Jones. I don't think there is... anything wrong with your heart. Mm. The reason I say that is that you've had an ECG, which has come back perfectly normal. And usually if there was a problem with the heart, the ECG would pick something up. Also, you've got none of the risk factors really for heart disease because you don't smoke. Your blood pressure, from what I can gather from your notes, has always been fine. You're fairly young. Before this, you were pretty fit and active.
Yeah.
And also, I know you're worried about your dad having had a heart attack, but actually, he was a lot older than you are. And so you're not really in the same risk sort of bracket as he would have been.
Right.
So I don't think that there is a problem with your heart. I guess what I'm wondering is whether actually what's going on is a little bit more what Dr. Jones thought, whether actually this might be the anxiety that's giving you a lot of these symptoms.
Mm.
Have you ever thought it might be that rather than a heart problem?
I think I've been thinking more recently it could be because, well, my friend has, like, panic attacks.
Right.
And I've discussed it with her and she said, to be honest, it just sounds like that. But I've always thought it was my heart. And what I can't understand is how my brain is making my heart start racing like it is.
Right. Mm. Okay. Has anyone explained to you about anxiety and panic attacks?
Not really, no.
Okay, well, perhaps it would be helpful to sort of hear a little bit more about that.
Yeah, okay.
What we have on top of our kidneys is two little glands, and they're called our adrenal glands.
Right.
And they produce a hormone called adrenaline. Have you heard of that?
Yes, I have heard of that.
Okay. And what adrenaline does is it prepares us for situations of fight or flight. Is that a term you perhaps remember from biology at school?
I do remember that.
Do you remember what we mean by fight or flight?
I think, like, if you're in a scary situation, you fight or you run away, basically.
Yeah.
Your body sort of triggers that to do it. Yeah.
That's exactly it. And what's released to allow you to do the flight or fight response is the adrenaline.
Right.
So when your body needs to get ready to do something, it surges out a load of adrenaline.
Mm.
And the adrenaline basically gets you ready for action.
Right, okay.
So it does things like it puts your heart rate up, it makes your breathing speed up so that you're ready to run. It can sometimes make people feel as though their mouth is dry.
Mm.
It can sometimes make people feel a bit lightheaded.
Yeah.
Are those the kind of symptoms that you can get?
Definitely. Yeah, definitely.
Mm-hmm.
All of those, actually.
Okay.
Mm.
What often happens with people with panic is that the first time that happens, the first adrenaline release, occurs out of the blue, perhaps at times of stress. And you mentioned that there was stuff going on at work and you were feeling a bit stressed out and you're in town, it was a bit hot.
Yeah.
And so that may have been what was behind that very first panic attack.
Mm. Mm.
What happens to people is that once they've had one panic attack, they go on to have more.
Mm.
And the reason for that is that once you've had something like that happen to you, you're kind of there thinking, ooh, will this happen again?
Yeah.
Is that something that you do?
Oh, absolutely. I've started to really monitor my heart. And when it starts to race, I start to get worried. And then it starts getting faster and faster. So it does feel...
Yeah. You're describing it exactly, Julie. That's what we call hypervigilance. So you're there kind of keeping a bit of an eye on your heart.
Yeah, definitely.
And for most of us, our heart rate will go up and down all through the day. But most of us don't worry about it because we don't notice it.
Right.
But because you've had a panic attack, you're there thinking, oh, what's my heart doing?
Yeah.
And then the minute it starts to change, you clock it, you notice it.
Mm.
And then you start to get anxious thoughts.
Yeah,
so you might
start worrying. I really do.
Start worrying.
So I keep thinking, is it going to be now? you know, is my heart going to stop beating?
Right, so you get those kind of anxious thoughts. And they're very frightening.
Very.
And because you're thinking, my goodness me, could my heart stop? That makes you even more anxious, and that causes even more adrenaline to be released.
Right.
And that makes the symptoms even more pronounced, and then that makes you believe even more that there's something wrong with you. Does that make sense as to what might be happening?
It does make sense, Doctor.
One of the things that you have been doing, which is something that a lot of people with anxiety do, is that you've started to avoid doing things that trigger it off.
I have,
Okay.
Yeah, like not walking into town or anything.
Exactly.
I just won't do it anymore.
Exactly. And whilst in the short term that sort of alleviates your symptoms because you don't have to get panicky, what's happening is that the more you avoid doing things, the less likely you are to ever get round to finding out whether or not anything awful really happens.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Right.
Does that make sense?
It does. It does make sense.
Well, if we are starting to tackle this as if it was an anxiety problem, there are a number of approaches. We can think about tablets, and we can think about other kind of talking approaches. There are pros and cons to those, and side effects and things that we need to discuss.
Okay.
So I'm just slightly watchful of the time. We seem to be coming to the end of today's session for the appointment, but what I wonder is whether we should meet again, perhaps next week, and look again more carefully at some of the treatment options and think together about which might suit you best.
Okay.
How would that sound, Julie?
No, that's fine, that's fine.
Any other questions before we finish?
No, I'll make an appointment to see you next week.
That's fine, and I'll see you next week.
Okay, thank you, Doctor.
It's a pleasure.
All right.
Bye-bye.